Everyone, I'm Mike.
I'm Matt.
We're Armchair Directors.
Get busy living or get busy dying.
You're gosh darn right. Taking a look at Mandalorian Chapter 6, The Prisoner. It's the prison break episode. And this kind of broke the streak for me. I like this episode, but I didn't love it. It's the first Mandalorian episode I haven't watched twice. I did go back and watch the last 5 minutes again, though, because of that.
Right.
That was precious. But I didn't feel the need to go back and watch this because I thought it was very different in tone from the other episodes. Very, very grim, dark, and just a lot of unpleasant people in it.
Yeah, and you know what? It was the first episode written by... that wasn't written by Filoni or Favreau.
Which is ironic because it's the first one with Filoni in it.
Right. So all the directors...
he thought that would offset it.
Three of the directors got a big cameo.
Yeah.
But this was written by Christopher Yost, who's not like one of the main creative showrunning guys. And it kind of felt like it. It definitely felt like a bottle episode where they're just going to go to this prison, do the whole thing there and kind of throw it away. But the beginning and the end that surround that whole prison mission were much more interesting than the actual prison break mission.
Mm-hmm.
And I think part of the problem for me was that the transition between last episode and this episode felt really abrupt.
Oh yeah.
Like all of a sudden Mando is here and I'm like, what? What about everything that just like happened on Tatooine and all that? And it's just like, no, this is a standalone episode that literally could be taken on its own and almost has nothing to do with any of the other episodes.
Yeah. That's one of the things I'm talking about when it feels different. I'm not just talking about the music or the lighting. Yeah. I'm talking about, wait a second, where's the flow?
Yeah, and even, like, I like when he gets there and Mark Boone Jr. from Batman Begins and Son of Anarchy is there. And, like, I like that character, and he was cool. And Bill Burr was, like, fine. He was fine as kind of the dick of
odd,
the
crew. Odd choice. I like Bill Burr, but Bill Burr as like the triple gun-toting scoundrel.
You know what? They've been doing a lot of casting where they get like comedians and they put them into these dramatic roles, and they've been doing it in almost every episode. Even last episode, the girl is best known as being a really wacky character on a show called Strangers with Candy. I almost said Stranger Things. But she's like a comedian, and she was the mechanic lady on Tatooine. And now they tried it again with Bill Burr, and like he just comes up short for me. And as they throw in more creatures, which is cool, we see some Twi'leks, but I hated the female Twi'lek. She was so annoying.
Yeah.
That I just, the way that like she was played, it was like over the top. And
I've got mouth makeup.
Yeah, I was gonna say I didn't like the teeth and how she was talking, and that chick was in Harry Potter and she was fine, but like I did not like that Twi'lek character. And you're expecting the double cross the whole time. Part of that was kind of interesting with the droids. I thought that was some cool action, but it just felt weird. Like, yeah, it didn't feel like the old Star Wars. It felt somewhere in between new and old. Like it was more prequel aesthetic than anything, I felt. But not...
It kind of felt like the Force Awakens scene with Han Solo when he's dealing with the... What were those monsters that he was...
Oh, the Rathtars.
Kind of like that. It was like an episode of that.
It was just a weird feeling. Like, It was the first one, and I only watched it once. And it's the
first one that I only watched once.
But it wasn't like I didn't think it was bad, but it wasn't great.
Yeah.
And
it all comes down to comparing it, grading it on a curve. Like, that's what it all comes down to. And it happens with movies all the time, too. We're not comparing this episode to the sixth episode of Stranger Things.
Right. Yeah.
Or Punisher. We're comparing it to the first five episodes of The Mandalorian.
Yeah. And I know a lot of people, like, really love this one, and I just didn't. But it's fine because...
I get it. Like,
it's a blip, right?
It's really well made. Like, I get it. It's really, really well made. It's just a different feel. And so I can get why people who love this one wouldn't love like the previous one.
And even watching it like, you know, Baby Yoda had to be in it, but when he shows up at first and like Bill Burr's like, what is this? And Baby Yoda gets friggin' smashed on the floor or whatever. I'm just like, this, I don't think the Mandalorian would be fine with like Bill Burr handling Baby Yoda like that, and especially they take a big tumble. Yeah. I feel like we've kind of established that he's very protective of him, and like, that is not an offense that we can just sort of let slide.
A lot of queer character. Yeah.
So that kind of quirk was weird, but I did love, like you said, Baby Yoda using the thing. Like, that was awesome. And the Mando outsmarting the bad guys was great. And when the X-Wings show up, that part was amazing. Thought that was really cool. But it was just some of those central characters while they go on this mission that I didn't care for. And we even get Matt Lanter to do a cameo, the voice of Anakin from Clone Wars.
Yeah.
Which was cool, but again, it was kind of almost more distracting because I was like, oh, it's Matt Lanter, and then he's like this nerdy kind of dude, and I was like, okay.
Why waste him?
Yeah, like,
he's so better than that. Like, we know he's better than that.
This episode felt half baked to me. Yeah. And I still liked it, but I didn't love it.
I definitely, when the X-Wing pilots showed up, my initial thought was, cool, X-Wing pilots. And then the way they were behaving was like, why are they so just normal? You know,
right.
like X-Wing pilots in the Star Wars movies are so cool. You know, this is hobby. I found them. Repeat, I found them. They're really edgy and intense. Even Wedge, who's not the most over-the-top guy, he's got his own quiet intensity. That's why we all love Wedge, too. These guys are just like, as like it was Dave Filoni. It wasn't Dave Filoni playing X-Wing pilot named So-So. Is that it over there? All right, let's blow it up. And can you explain to me why they blew that thing up? Just because the beacon is flashing? Like, isn't there any safety precautions that say, that's not the prison?
Right.
So there might have been some sort of mix-up here. Like, I understand, blow up the prison if it gets taken over. Absolutely. That's a dangerous situation. You don't want to go in and try to salvage the place. There's lots of dangerous people that you don't want escaping. But this is, was it a trading post?
Yeah.
And you blow it up? Like, doesn't that kind of seem like a war crime or something?
Especially just because they were just following a portable beacon that could be taken from a different location and brought to there, and they just, like, without, no questions asked, shoot first, ask questions later.
So if the explanation is they're just idiot X-Wing pilots, that's not a satisfying explanation either.
Yeah.
Like, it's there. I don't see how that's, again, up to the quality of what we've seen written prior.
Yeah, and this was the episode that felt the most like a TV show to me, that rather than, you know, we've had the other ones that, even though I felt some of them were kind of episodic, they still felt like the scope of a movie. But this, for me, felt more like the scope of a TV show. Like I said, partly because we confined to that prison for a lot of it, where it's like, okay, we only got two hallways, we got to make use of it. And like every time they would go around a corner, I could just feel like the cut of them repurposing the camera to make the same hallway feel like a different hallway.
Yeah.
Right? And so like it was the only time I felt like I'm watching a TV show right now, not like the same Star Wars scope that the rest of the series had had.
And a jarring change after leaving Tatooine.
Yeah.
So immersed in nostalgia and so spacious. And then you go to this claustrophobic, and that was probably by design. We're going to go from that to that. But very small claustrophobic area. I did like how 70s it looked, though. I thought it was like, it was very New Hope, Blockade Runner, and Battlestar Galactica. So I thought, wow, this is a new show, which looks fantastic, but they've really decided hard to go with 70s sci-fi look here.
Yeah.
Logan's Run and
all
those. Yeah,
it did feel like a Logan's Run kind of thing. Absolutely. So mixed bag for me.
Still
good, yeah, because like you said, it's grading on a curve. Compared to the other episodes, I don't hold it in as high regard. Compared to the latest episode of, you know, Supernatural or something, yeah, I like this a lot.
Yeah, and for, I'm a big Firefly fan, so there's a lot of Firefly influence in there too. That type of feeling. So cool. You know, doesn't derail anything. I'm still super excited about the next one. So
yep.
No real no real damage done. And who knows, maybe it was, like I said earlier, by design to get people a little more excited for the Rise of Skywalker this week.
And I think it very much could be, especially because we had that Boba Fett tease at the end that we don't even hint at in this. They totally tabled to maybe have that be in a later episode closer to Rise of Skywalker. And this episode launched on a Friday, and the next episode was going to launch on a Wednesday because of Skywalker. So I feel like they kind of are with a smaller window. Yeah. Maybe they knew, like, okay, this episode, even if we just kind of brush past it, it's fine.
Yeah. So let us know what you thought of Logan's Run in the comments below. And if you haven't seen Logan's Run, then let us know what you thought of this episode. Thanks a lot for watching, and until next time,
enjoy the show.
Logan's Run.
How many people are going to download Logan's Run now?
The heck is Logan's Run?